Lord, in you I live and move. Lord, in you I live and move. In you I live and move. Have my being. Lord, in you I live and move. In you I live and move. In you I live and move.
Than any other. Oh,
place in you, Lord.
Let your sun be revealed in us. Let your sun be revealed. Perfect way.
Your way in us.
Your
your perfect way in us.
Surrender all to you. We surrender all to you. Lord, we surrender all to you. Lord, we surrender all to you. Lord, we surrender all to you. 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 You gave your all for us, so we give all to you, Lord, holding nothing back from you, God.
Yes, Lord.
Holding nothing back. Holding nothing back. We count nothing dear unto ourselves, Lord, but you. Your will, your way, Lord. Your will, your way. Your will, your way, Lord. Your will, your perfect way. For we surrender all to you. Lord, we surrender all to you. Oh, we surrender all to you. Lord, we surrender all to you. Oh, we surrender all to you. Lord, we surrender all to you. We surrender. We surrender. We surrender all to
to you. Lord, we surrender all to you. We surrender all to you. We surrender all to you. Lord, have your way in us. Your perfect way. In us, Lord, have your way in us. Would your perfect way in us, Lord, have your way in us. Your perfect way in us.
Father, we thank you for the manifestation of the Holy Ghost and power in this place. Father, we thank you for your glory that comes and saturates this place. It fills every heart, it fills every life. Lord Jesus, we are hungry for you. Lord Jesus, we are desperate for you. Father, we thank you for the fire of revival that you have purposed to pour forth out of each and every one of us. The fires of the Holy Ghost. Holy Spirit, we thank you for the cries of heaven. Father, for the sounds of heaven that pour forth out of our lives, out of our very beings, like rivers. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Holy Spirit. The Father has purpose for you to have a voice. The Father has purpose for you to speak forth those things which he would have you declare on his behalf. There is a realm of consecration that you must step into where you yield your tongue only to those things that God would speak, to say only those things that are in the perfect will and perfect plan of God. God is looking for a vessel to use, but he's got to have one that is consecrated for his purposes. There can be no mixture. We're too easily entangled in the things of this world and the cares and the pleasures and the riches, and we are living two lives, this life of hypocrisy, where there is a life that is seen in church and the building and the things that go on within the realms of this place, and then what goes on outside. It cannot be. Father is looking to pour out his fire. It is a pure fire. It is a holy fire, and there must be vessels of honor. To bring that forth, to pour it forth. Father wants to give you a voice. Father wants to give you a voice, but you must consecrate your tongue and your mouth and your life and everything about you over to him. We are living in a time of great compromise. We are living in a time where everything is good, everything is acceptable. You can come as you are and leave as you came. It is not the reality of the gospel. It is not the reality of the kingdom. And it is not what Jesus preached. Father, with open arms, with his loving kindness, sent his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to invite everyone, whosoever, no matter the state, no matter the condition, to come. But he demanded change. He demanded a lifestyle change. A lifestyle change where you do not live the same. You do not think the same. You do not speak the same. The Christian life as it is seen today is riddled with compromise. And it must cease. And it cannot be in this place. Father wants to give you a voice. Father wants to give you a voice. He wants to raise you up as his representative on the earth to speak those things which he has purposed to speak. But there must be consecration. There must be consecration. Father, tonight we say to you, we are yours. Father, again, we commit ourselves to live for you. Father, we are grateful for your mercy and your grace, for the blood of Jesus that washes us, that cleanses us, that gives us yet another opportunity to change. Father, to turn from our own life, to turn from our own cares, our own pursuits, our own compromises. And Father, look to you. Father, we will look to you. Lord Jesus, we ask you to forgive us for the areas that we have allowed compromise. Lord Jesus, we repent. We turn away from our sin, from our ungodliness, from our own human earthly pursuits. Father, come and touch our hearts. Father, come and fill us with such a desire to seek only those things of the kingdom. Father, those things which you have purposed. Father, find in this place a people that is hungry, that is desperate. Father, that is only seeking after you. Father, find in us one desire, one eye, one focus to see you, to see your glory, to see your church shine forth with the brightness, with the glory, with the splendor that you have purposed. Father, use us. Father, use us. Father, in this dark time, in this dark hour, raise up a standard in this place. Father, let the light of your glory shine. Oh God, oh God, oh God, in your mercy, let your glory be seen. Father, in your mercy, let the light of the gospel shine in us. Father, we must have you. Father, we must have you. You are the only answer. Lord Jesus, you are the only truth. We are desperate for you, God. We are desperate for you, God. Father, make us desperate. Make us hungry. Father, forgive us for being satiated with the things of this world. Father, forgive us for being completely filled up with our own desires, that we're not thirsty, that we're not hungry, that we're not passionately desperate for just you. Father, we repent. Father, thank you that you fill us with the Spirit to be desperate, to be hungry for one thing and one thing only. You, Lord Jesus. You, Lord Jesus. Father, I thank you that you come and you move in this place. You bring such a change. You bring such a convicting power of your Holy Ghost that we are absolutely repulsed by the life that we have lived. Father, that we turn away from the filthy, beggarly garments that we have so long stood captivated by. And Father, that we put on the glorious garments of the life, this glorious garment of the life of Jesus. Father, thank you that you open our eyes to see. That we no longer be stuck playing in the dirt with a few pebbles and rocks when you have purpose for us to be sitting in the palace, surrounded by the riches of your glory, your treasures. Father, you know that the blind cannot see. I ask you, Father, in your miracle power, open the eyes of the blind. Father, we have sat spiritually blinded. Open our eyes so that we may see, Father, that the revelation of the state of our being, Father, the state of the church would be so apparent that we would be broken. Father, that we would be desperate to see change. Absolutely desperate, Father, to see change beginning in our lives. Father, that we would not give 8, 10, 12 hours a day to ourselves seeking after our own riches, our own fame, our own fortune. But Father, rather we would turn to seeking after those things of the kingdom. The Father is looking for someone who will intercede on his behalf. Father is looking for someone that will raise up their voice on his behalf. The intercessors of hell are crying out. They're speaking out daily. Vehemently they're crying out, spewing out their evil. Where are those? Where are those who would intercede on behalf of the Father, who would cry out, speaking those things which God has purposed to speak out? Father, I thank you for the spirit of prayer and supplication that falls in this church. Father, the spirit of prayer and supplication that fills your house. Father, no longer would we sit chattering, yammering, speaking gossip, speaking nonsense, when you have purposed for us to speak as your oracles, for us to declare the things in the spirit, for us to bind those things on earth that should be bound, and to loose those things that need be loosed, and you loose in the heavenly realm, you bind in the spiritual. Father, give us wisdom, give us understanding, give us insight. And Father, most importantly, put in us such a desperation for you. Father, a desperation for you. Casual Christianity is a false reality. It is non-existent. Everything about the kingdom of God is passion. It is emotion. It is great demonstrations of exuberance. We cannot be lullabied any longer. The modern church has become a comfortable place, a place that is quote-unquote not judgy, a place that lets you remain the same. That is not the reality of the gospel. And in Jesus' name, it is not the reality of the church in this place. Thank you, Father, for the glory of heaven. Thank you, Father, for the breakthrough. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. We worship you, Father. We praise you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Jesus, your glory in this place. Thank you, Holy Spirit. It's radical to think about the fact that God has purposed and God has ordained to use us. James talks about the tongue. The tongue being set on fire, right? Of hell, or you set on fire of the Holy Ghost. We have got to raise up our voice. We have got to begin to speak out these things that God would have us to speak. The secret place that God has called us to for years and years and years, the place of prayer, the place of intercession. How many of us have truly taken on the mantle, have truly arisen to the call? Simply because we believe that our prayer can change the atmosphere. Our prayer can move things in the spirit. I would venture to say not many. Not many. So I have to ask you, why the unbelief? Because if you truly believed that when you stepped into your prayer closet, when you stepped into a place of petitioning the Father that he would answer, guarantee you'd be there. So tonight I want to bring forth a challenge to ask you, what is it that is getting in the way? Maybe you truly believe that when you pray, the Father hears and he'll do those things. But you're easily distracted because you've got the mortgage and the car payment and you've got to take care of the college fund and all the other stuff. Nothing wrong with them unless they're keeping you away from your purpose, the purpose that God has ordained for you to fulfill in the earth. Father, in Jesus' name, may this not just be more words. Father, in Jesus' name, I thank you that this go forth on ears that are ready to receive. Thank you, Father, for the glory of heaven. Father, for the witness of the Spirit. The witness of the Spirit. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Father's calling. He's always calling. Who will answer? Who will answer? Jesus. Father, I'll answer. Father, I'll answer. Father, I'll answer. Father, find in me a yielded vessel. Oh, Lord Jesus, Lord Jesus, Lord Jesus. I know God wants to do things in this place tonight. My one job is to host the presence of the Holy Ghost, to bring in that manifest presence where the life-changing touch of God, the reality of the supernatural realm that God lives in, can come and touch you. That's all I want to do, because that's what's going to change. That's what's going to change you. Jesus, Lord Jesus, Lord Jesus, Lord Jesus, we thank you for your presence, for your anointing, for your glory. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Jesus. Hallelujah. It's very important to learn how to flow in the Holy Ghost. Excuse me. Not doing your own thoughts, your own idea, your own preconceived notions as to what God would want to do. It's easy to do. It's easy to do. We've got our daily routines. We've got things figured out. We've got our schedules lined up. Planners are full. But too often, we're trading in what God would want to use us, these radical things of the kingdom, supernatural demonstrations of his miracle power, for our planners, our little calendars. We put God on hold because we're too busy doing the things that we have planned. Can't be. And what I want to talk to you tonight a little bit about is the false realities, these false worlds that we've created in our own mind, the dictates of the God of this world, and the realities of simply our human existence. Most Christian reality does not line up with what God's reality is. So how do we know what God's reality is? Where is that laid out? Simply in his word. Our own ideas and our own concepts of what is right and what is good are far from what God has established. It doesn't take a whole lot of discernment to look across the scope of what is our modern world to realize there's some seriously skewed thinking. If you're basing your reality, if you're basing who you are off of the modern trends of what is important, you are in a bad state. But if you begin to let the word define your reality, you'll begin to see areas where you've allowed mixture, where you've allowed compromise, where you've assimilated into the culture of this world when God has called us out of the culture of this world. Turning to the word is the only safe place. God's not changing. His definition of reality will remain the same forever. You have one of two options. You can live in the realm, the reality that God dictates, or you can live in a reality that Satan dictates. Men think they're living in some neutral free zone, some human area that they're creating. It doesn't exist. It's one of two options. And I would invite you tonight to let God define your reality. The basis of this, the understanding of this, comes from one place, and that is by the Holy Ghost. The reality of being born of the Spirit. So that's what I want to talk to you tonight. Excuse me, my goodness. I sound like I'm either a baby or 80. Excuse me. We're going to start off in John chapter 3, verse 1. We're going to go through verse 6. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I know you guys know this story well. It's the story of Nicodemus and the great question that he posed to Jesus. So I'm going to read it to you. And if my voice sounds annoying to you, it sounds annoying to me as well. I apologize. Bear with me. Not because I have an annoying voice, but because it's getting like all scratchy. you guys know what I mean. Here we go. Nicodemus comes to Jesus, and here's what he says. We'll just start in verse 1. I want to read through this story. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. The same came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher from God, for no man can do these miracles that you do except God be with him." Jesus answered and said unto him, "Truly, truly, I say unto you, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Nicodemus said to him, "How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a man be born of the water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. That which is born of the Spirit is spirit." Every person that is born into this world is born of the flesh. They are flesh. They have a flesh nature. No matter how good of a person, no matter how nicely the package, it's never good enough. Nicodemus, being the ruler of the Jews, personified this perfectly for us because he was the cream of the crop. He is like top notch, right? He is the guy that had it going on. He had the right religion. He was the leader of it. And Jesus said, "You cannot enter the kingdom of heaven unless you be born again." The reality that I'm talking to you about, the message that I want to convey tonight, is the reality of God's kingdom. It can only happen when you become and when you are born of the Spirit. Now, you may be asking yourself, "I know this, I've heard this message, I'm born of the Spirit, I'm walking in the Spirit." Okay, that's fine. But there's a reason God has me ministering this and speaking this. There are areas in your life that must change. I'm not seeing the complete full maturation that God has called us to. So as I speak this out, whether you've heard it, whether you're hearing it for the first time or you've heard it 1,000 times, you need to listen, because God has got a desperate heart. It's wild to think about. God has a desperate heart to use you. And there's things that must be adjusted. There's things that must be addressed in your life. There's compromises that have taken place that have to stop. We're going to get into the scripture, but we all know if we're walking in the Spirit, we are not going to fulfill the lust of the flesh. Now, the question that is posed is, why is it that we oscillate? Why is it that you can be walking in the Spirit and then turn, do your own thing? Where are the areas that you've allowed Satan to have a grip, compromises to take place? Now, as I speak this forth, as the word goes forth, there's always the three reactions: mad, sad, or glad. One of the biggest pitfalls and one of Satan's best tactics employs as this message of liberation is going forth is he brings condemnation of, "Oh, I'm not good enough. I'm failing again. Here we go. Pastor's yelling at us. We're not good enough." That is not the point of the message. The point of the message is empowerment. The point of the message is the world is nuts. The world is in a crazy place right now, and somebody's got to be the answer. So, how are we going to be the answer? We've got to step out of the reality of what we've classified as a good little world and come into God's reality, what God has defined as truth. Let's jump over to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17 and 18. Second Corinthians 5, 17 and 18. "Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. And all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ." Oh, hallelujah. "And has given to us the ministry of reconciliation." Beautiful. Thank you, Lord Jesus. The sacrifice that the Lord Jesus poured out himself for us, so that this ministry of reconciliation could come forth, that we would have a new life, a new reality. It is the truth of the gospel. We must step in to God's reality. We must begin to be renewed in the spirit of our mind, thinking differently about ourselves, thinking differently about what is going on within the realms of the spirit, within the realms of what's naturally taking place, seeing things through God's lens, God's reality. In order to even be on the same page here, you must start where Jesus started, what he told Nicodemus. There's no ability to even relate or live in the reality that God has established unless we are born of the Spirit. As I mentioned earlier, I think most people in here have been born of the Spirit. You have to ask yourself, where is it that you are at in the maturation process? Because Paul tells us that we can be like babies, tossed to and fro, right? Or we can be established men, sons in the house who do the bidding of the Father, who do the Father's work. God's reality is made up of those who have stepped into another world, the realms of the Spirit, the dimensions of heaven. I've recently been going through one of A.B. Simpson's writings, Walking in the Spirit. It's an awesome one. How many of you guys have read that? It's posted on the website, Walking in the Spirit. I would encourage you to read it. It's going to be good for you. Actually, I would say you need to read it. You really need to read it. Okay? So I'm going to give you one of the things that he opens up with in that writing, and it's awesome because basically the totality of the writing is simply the new creation, now being born of the Spirit, the life that we are called to live, walking by the Spirit, moving in the Spirit, and it's fantastic, okay? So let me again say, read it and listen to this. So this is what he opens up with. We may have the brightest intellectual life, the most unblemished moral character, and the most amiable qualities of disposition, and yet without the new life of the Holy Spirit in our heart, we can no more enter heaven than the lovely canary that sings in our window can become a member of our family, or the gentle lamb that our children play with can sit down at our table and share domestic fellowship and enjoyment. It belongs to a different world, and nothing but a new nature and a human heart could bring it into fellowship with our human life. The most exalted intellect, the most attractive natural disposition, reach no higher than the earthly. He's writing here and he's giving an earthly kind of natural example of what Jesus is talking about to Nicodemus. There's the natural flesh realm and then there's being born of the Spirit. A.B. Simpson goes on to write, and Pastor Mark has shared about this a number of times, the levels of life. You've got your vegetative life, your plant life. You've got your animal life, your human life. And then you've got this life of the Spirit. Now, as infinitely higher as human existence, human intelligence, human life is from a plant life, that much and more is the life of the Spirit that God has called us to. It's a completely different way of thinking. It's a completely different way of living, moving, conducting all of your affairs. It's too easy to get stuck in a natural existence. You don't want to do it. You don't want to do it. You want to have the passion of God, so filling your heart, the reality of the kingdom of God within your understanding that you realize you're coming up way short. It's wasted potential to live your life as a mere mortal, a just human natural realm is a complete waste because God has called you to live the life of the Spirit, a life that defies nature, defies even natural laws, is able to work the supernatural, is able to do the miraculous. That is the exciting life. That is an incredible, incredible life that God so desires that we step into. In order to do it, we must begin to walk, to live, to move, to think after the Spirit. There's a very stark contrast of the heavenly life compared to the natural life. And if you get a hold of this, if you really get serious about this, if you take it maybe even as serious as a simple exam, to quantify, where are you at? How much of this is truly a reality? How many of your decisions are you basing completely off of your own intellect, your own resources, the things that you can figure out, and how many of those decisions are you basing off the word, faith, what God would have you do in the situation? If you start counting them, it'll challenge you. It'll challenge you, and you'll realize just how earthly we have confined ourselves to, when all the while God has liberated us into a realm that is limitless. Is your life, the life of the Spirit, truly different than the human existence that you would otherwise live? Just reiterating what I said a second ago. Would there really be a difference in the way you live if you were saved or if you weren't? You have to ask yourself this. If I was unsaved, just a good person living out my life, what are the things that are, where's the contrast? What is it that I can say, yep, this is not a natural way of living. This is a supernatural way of living. This is walking in the Spirit, and here's how I can quantify it. You have to ask yourself these questions, because too many people are comfortable with where they're at. The church is too comfortable. They're not asking. Look, is it a tough question? Yeah. Does it demand change? Absolutely. Would most people prefer to just coast on through? Yeah, look around. What I'm doing tonight is I see in front of me a group of people that are committed to the things of God, the things of the kingdom. And what I want to do is I want to speak by the Holy Spirit to spur you on, to just push you forward and say, look, guys, let's just be honest. Let's just have the reality of God's reality in our lives and do some simple quantifying. What is it that we're doing that is truly by the Spirit? How much of the things that we are doing step out of a natural, comfortable, earthly realm? And how many of those things could you just say, yeah, I can do that. Whether I'm born of the Spirit or not, I can do that. You have to ask yourself. Because the word says of our own selves, what can we do? Hey. So, walk in the Spirit. That's what Jesus demands. Be born of the Spirit and walk in the Spirit. Okay, so let's look at some of this. Let's look at some of this contrast. The word paints a very, very good contrast for us. What it looks like to walk in the flesh, what it looks like to walk in the Spirit. We're going to look in Galatians 5:16. Galatians 5, verse 16. This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary to one another, so that ye cannot do the things that you would. But if ye would be led of the Spirit, you're not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are manifested, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, sedition, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like. Of the which I tell you before, as I have told you in times past, that they which do these things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Okay, so that's the base. Everything that would be of the flesh, this earthly existence, this sinful nature, this flesh realm that God is saying, you can't be after walking after the flesh, you have to walk after the Spirit. I would venture to say most of those things are not even hardly a temptation for the majority of everyone in here. But there are things that are within this list that we allow. And God doesn't say, this one's really bad, this one's kind of bad, this one's not as bad. He simply lists them all out, okay? One of the biggest oppositions, one of the greatest challenges that the church has to face is the bickering, is the strife, is the backbiting, the evil speaking that goes on. It is detrimental. And it's listed here. You guys see strife there and sedition and heresies? It's right up there with the rest of the ones that you might classify as absolutely hideous. To God, they're all hideous. And what I want to challenge you tonight, as God spoke earlier, just at the start of this meeting, He wants to give you a voice. He wants to give you a voice. And the only way that you're going to have a voice that is impacting, a voice that carries forth that anointing, is having a place of consecration in your life where you do not allow evil speakings, you do not allow strife, you do not allow anything of sedition. We have got to recognize the areas that we allow it, and it has to stop. Amen? Father, thank you for the floodlight at heaven that shines on each and every one of us. Holy Spirit, that you show us the areas that need correction, that need change, and in Jesus' name, no more compromise, no more allowing of those things that are of the flesh, that are preventing the will and purpose of God being revealed. None of those things are part of God's reality. Walking in the Spirit has nothing to do with those things that I just listed out. It's not in the reality. Let's look again. Let's go further again here. Colossians 3, verse 5. Colossians 3, 5. Mortify, therefore, your members. It means put it to death. It needs to be dead, which are upon the earth. These things. Here we go. Fornication, uncleanness, inordinate affections, evil concupiscence, and covetousness, which is idolatry, for which things sake the wrath of God comes on the children of disobedience, in the which ye also walked sometimes when you lived in them. But now you also put off these things, anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy communication out of your mouth. Lie not one to another, seeing that you have put off the old man with his deeds. The works of the flesh, the works of ungodliness, they have no place in the reality of God's kingdom. You might be asking yourself, why are you talking to me about this? What is it that you're seeing? What is going on? Why do I have to hear this message again? Because, first and foremost, the message is not going forth like it needs to. We need to have it being spoken in our mouth. And most importantly, there's things that God is dealing with your heart. There's things that God wants to show you tonight. Areas that you have allowed, compromises. Things that are preventing you. Things that are keeping you back from walking in the Spirit as the Holy Ghost has purposed for you to walk. The mercy and the grace of God is unbelievable. It blows me away. Unfathomable. But He demands change. And what I want to encourage you again tonight, recognize the areas. Identify the areas where you have allowed things that are not of the Spirit, where you are not walking after the Spirit. Amen? So let's turn over here and let's look at what God's reality is, what it looks like, the good things that God has purposed, what walking in the Spirit looks like, the goodness, the true life. We'll continue on here in Colossians chapter 3. Jump down to verse 12. Put on, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, vows of mercy, kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, long-suffering, forbearing one another, and forgiving one another. If any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, so also do ye. And above all these things, put on charity, which is the bond of perfectness. And let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to the which also you're called in one body. And be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another, in psalms, in hymns, in spiritual songs, singing with grace in your heart to the Lord. And whatsoever you do in word or in deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by Him. Now that's a beautiful picture. That's an awesome reality. That's what God has purposed. The good things. Everything, there is not a bad thing in that list, is there? No, there's not. The contrast is in the preceding verses. What is going on in the reality of this world, the God of this world, that's what He lives in. That's all He knows. Let me step back and just for a second maybe give you a simple definition of what I mean by, I keep saying reality, God's reality. What do I mean by that? I mean that everything that exists within God's world, everything that it exists as a person who is walking in the Spirit, walking after the Spirit, these are the things that are supposed to be there. The Holy Spirit lives and dwells. His entire reality is centered around holiness. Make sense? Not a tough concept to get. Is the Holy Spirit ever going to be bringing anything of sin and ungodliness? No, he's never going to do it. His entire reality, the entire reality that he has given us, dwells and lives and abides in this holiness, this consecration, this reality of God's kingdom. Are you with me? So, why is it, you may ask? Okay, well, I get that. I want to be walking in the Spirit. Why are you having to deal with temptation, these different things that are in the world? Well, that's the contrast. While we're in this world, this present world, we're going to have to deal with the things, right? But what are we supposed to be doing? Not walking after the flesh, walking after the Spirit. Amen? It's an absolutely beautiful place. It's a place of glory. It's a place of all of God's goodness. I want to read this scripture real quick, Titus 2:11. For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that to deny ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a precious, chosen, peculiar people, zealous of good works. Praise God. That is the reality of the kingdom. That is the reality of what Jesus poured out his life for, to create this world, to create this reality for us, the Spirit. Let's go a little further. Let's go back to Galatians 5. We're going to be in verse 22, Galatians 5, 22. But the fruits of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And they that are Christ's have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. The word clearly lays out, clearly defines what it looks like to be walking in the Spirit. The attitudes, the way we're talking, the way we're living, everything, the way we're treating people. It's very easy if you'll just step back, take a point of view, whatever the situation throughout the day may be, and ask yourself, am I walking in the Spirit or am I doing my own thing? Am I yielding over to something that is not of the fruits of the Spirit, not of the gifts of the Spirit, not of the reality of the Holy Spirit? We have to do it. We have to be committed and dedicated enough to these things where we'll stop. Stop what we're doing and say, Holy Spirit, I'm doing it my own. Forgive me. Forgive me for ignoring you. I yield to you now. And it's as simple as that, because he's always there. He's waiting, eagerly waiting to just be able to flow through you. He's right there. You have received a new heart and a new spirit. He has put his spirit, God has put his spirit on the inside of us. And it's not like he's making us earn anything here. It's simply a matter of yielding to the reality. This is how I live my life. These are the laws of God. This is the reality that God lives in. And it is the reality that those who walk in the Spirit must live in. Men around the world, just doesn't take much, look around, they hate the laws of God. They want nothing to do with the laws of God. Men's hearts and minds become just twisted, evil. They have no ability to rationally think. It's as simple as that. I say, that's kind of a outlandish statement. They have no ability to rationally think. They're thinking after a human realm. Yeah, it's a little bit of an intense statement, but it's truth, because this is reality. The Word of God is reality. No matter what is going on, no matter what the latest trend is, no matter what is being said by man, God's word remains forever. Amen? People are more concerned with the laws of man, social issues, than they are with the laws of God. And it's absolutely insane. Let me give you an example. I'm sure all of you have heard about the lion, right? The little cat that the guy shot. You know what I'm talking about? Cecil the lion? Okay, so over the past however long, 1 million people have signed this petition for the dentist to be, you know, indicted and sent over to be judged in the court in I think it's Zimbabwe, right? Well, all the while, 300,000 babies a year are aborted. You know how many signatures that got? You know how many signatures the petition to defund Planned Parenthood got? Not many. Didn't even break 100,000. Crazy, right? So I made a pretty bold statement saying that men's reality is, their way of thinking is completely outlandish. You tell me that that's a good way of thinking. That a cat can get a million signatures, right? But what's going on in today's world of murdering unborn children by the hundreds of thousands doesn't even bat an eye. That's twisted. And that is why I'm calling you tonight to step out of the reality that men would dictate, to step out of the reality of an earthly living and come over into the reality of the kingdom of God. It's not really much of a surprise that, you know, the political agenda to defund Planned Parenthood didn't even get past the starting stages. Like, I barely even, like, it's a vote to even vote on it, right? Like, didn't even get past the initial stages. Not a chance. I hate to admit it, but it's no surprise. Because what men have placed as a priority is so far away from what God has placed on as a priority. What God looks at as important. Life, the very human existence, is meaningless to us. We have to get serious enough about this and get a little uncomfortable talking about it. No one's comfortable talking about this, thinking about it. But if we just sweep it under the rug, who's going to address it? Who is going to make the change? Because guess what? It's not going to change on its own. Well, we'll just let it ride. We'll just let it work itself out. It's not going to work itself out. Things will only get worse. So why don't you go ahead and bear the brunt of it a little bit, put a little weight on your shoulders and say, no, you know what? This is a reality that is completely false. What is being dictated by the government, what is the social norm, is not at all the reality that God has established. You, as the church, as the sons and daughters of God, must stand up, first and foremost, knowing what is God's reality. What is it to walk in the Spirit? What does it look like to move in the Spirit? And on that foundation, then stand up and say, no, this is how it's going to be, because this is reality. When you are solidified in what is a reality, a foreign concept that is completely false, you cannot be convinced of it. There's things that I know, I could give many examples. There's things that I know that there's no way you could convince me otherwise. I know it to be true. It is my reality. Now, what you must be careful in is not defining your own reality based upon the perceptions and the things that you have come to conclude. It's basing your reality on the Word of God. What God has said is truth. Amen? Now, I use that example, and I talked about that for a second, because the contrast has to become real to you. This has to hit you in the heart, and I don't know what could touch your heart more than murdering an innocent child. I mean, if that doesn't touch you, you got a disconnect somewhere. So what I'm asking you to do, and what the Father is demanding that we do, is to get on our knees and to begin to cry out for a change to take place, for a change within ourselves. The change will always happen first and foremost here, in me. You have to decide, it's as simple as this, I see a problem. I want to be the answer to the problem. Father, make me the answer. Recognize that you have to take the responsibility. No one else is going to be demonstrating to the world what it looks like to be in God's kingdom, what it looks like to live in God's reality. We have to do it. Amen? Is it a job? Yeah. Is it work? Yeah. Is it worth it? Yes. I loved what Pastor Joel said a couple weeks ago. He painted that picture of a line just wrapped around, you know, extensive line, everyone that's standing in front of the white throne of judgment. You guys remember that? And what did he say his motivation was? Just shortening that line. If he could just be used by God to shorten that line a little bit. That hit me. That was heavy. It was intense. So if I ask myself, how can I do that? What does that look like? And then I go and I'm studying this out. Father, how am I going to do this? How am I going to do this? Answer is simple. The answer is clearly laid out. You must walk in the Spirit. Because it's as simple as this. Pick any person that signed the Lion petition, right? You're not going to be able to intellectually convince them that the other petition is more important. It's just, it's a lost argument. They've got their priorities, they've got their reality, and to try to argue with somebody is completely futile. What you must do is walk in the power and the demonstration of the Holy Ghost, where it supersedes the natural intellectual realm as high as the intellectual is above that vegetative, even more so. You got to come in the realm of the Spirit, walking after the Spirit. That is the only answer. That is the only way that there will be breakthrough. So, if we know that that is why and that is how and that's what we must do, we have to ask ourselves, what is preventing us from walking in the Spirit? If you will get serious enough about it, and it's not that you're trying to work it out and do whatever, it's simply getting hungry, getting desperate enough to say, Father, I'm not having the reality of what you demand for my life. I'm not walking in the Spirit. I'm not doing the things that you have purposed for me to do. I need to change. That simple prayer, that simple, honest, sincere heart to say, Father, I want to change. I want to do this. The Holy Spirit is there to empower. It simply takes the commitment, the asking for the Holy Ghost to just rush in and fill your heart. It's easy. Everybody raise your hands. I'm losing some of you. Some of you are going to sleep. Wave it out a little bit. Is this important to anyone?
Yes.
Praise God. We must have the reality of the kingdom of God. We must see the demonstration of the Holy Ghost in this city. It is the only answer. It is the only solution. It is the only thing that will change the present circumstance, the chaos that is our present world. And it is that complete chaos. I want you to turn to 1 John 3. The Father's so inviting. He's so welcoming. He just beckons us to come. It's such an easy decision. It's such a simple change of heart, change of mind, change of desires. And he puts his desires on the inside of us. There's no reason not to do this. Do not be robbed of your purpose. Do not be robbed of this life because you're stuck doing your own thing. Hear the invitation. Hear the invitation. Behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore, the world knows us not because it knew him not. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it does not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Every man that has this hope in him purifies himself, even as he is pure. Do not be so earthly minded, so earthly consumed that you would reject the love of God, reject this invitation in. The things of this world can be alluring. They can draw you in. But what is it that would be more appealing than that love that God has poured out? There can be nothing. What is it that you'd say, I can't give that up? I'm holding on to this thing in my life, and I just can't give it up. The love of God sounds good. This life of the Spirit sounds nice, but you know what? I just can't give up this. There can't be anything. God demands a single heart, a single eye, and nothing more important than him. The reward is well worth it. Let me tell you, when you come and you taste and you see that the Lord is good, you look back and you say, what in the world was I thinking? What took me so long? You don't want to be delayed any longer. You don't want to hold on to things any longer that would keep you back. Does it really give you that much of a high to talk bad about somebody that you can't move on in the things of God? Is it that important for you to belittle someone and speak evil of someone? Is it really that important to you? It's got that much of a grip on you. You can't let it go. Because that is one of the biggest problems. That is what I see, and that's what I hear in my spirit that is keeping so many of God's people back. It's the running in the mouth. They can't stop putting somebody down. They can't stop speaking bad about somebody. The gossip circles. Give me a break. Stop. Please stop. Just stop. The things of the kingdom are so precious. They are so beautiful. Put aside the earthly, fleshly things that would prevent you from walking in the life of the Spirit. There are a lot of awesome models. There are a lot of men of God, examples that you can look to that are moving in the Spirit, that are walking in the Spirit, that are doing things that are mind-blowing. I mean, miracles, signs, wonders, demonstration of the Holy Ghost that is beautiful. I watch it. There's a lot of cool YouTubes. You can look at old ones from the past and even guys today that are doing this, that are doing the work. That needs to inspire you. That needs to grab a hold of your heart. That needs to stir something on the inside of you that says, you know what, I've got to have that. That's going to provoke you to good works. And more importantly, even better, just look to the Word. Look at the ministry of Jesus. The last time I ministered to you, the last time I spoke, it was all about living the life of Christ, living the life of Jesus. We have got to be so stirred up to do these things. God has already purposed it. He's already given, like it's a blank check. Go and do it. We're not waiting on Him to fulfill His end of the bargain here. He's waiting on us. He has fulfilled it all. He's saying, go and do it. Simply be committed. Resolve in your heart that no matter what, you do it. There's one guy, one man of God I've been watching quite a bit, inspirational. God is just using him. I mean, the statistics that he has in terms of how many people get healed that he prays for are awesome, like astoundingly good. He said, people think that I just started praying one day, laying hands on people, and it all just started happening, and now everybody that I prayed for gets healed. It didn't happen. He said, I prayed for 10 people a day for a year. No one got healed. That's a lot of people. He didn't let up. He refused to let what he saw in the natural dictate his reality. He has a reality defined by God. I have a reality defined by God. You know what it tells me? My Bible tells me that I'll lay hands on the sick and they will recover. That we go everywhere casting out devils. Raising the dead even. That's an intense one. So if I let that reality, God's reality, define my life, it doesn't matter what I see. I know what God has purposed, and you don't let up. That is what we call contending. Right? That is pressing in to a place where God can use you, God can mold you, God can shape you, and you just stay after it. That is fun stuff. That is exciting stuff. Do not be stuck in the stuff that is so petty, the stuff that is so earthly, that you be held back, that you be stuck from going on in the things of God. Amen? There cannot be a church life. We can't know you as one person in this building and see you in the street, see you at school, see you at work, and you look like a different person. You're acting different, you're talking different, whatever. That is called hypocrisy. I hate it. God hates it. It is a terrible state, and that is unfortunately what has been presented as the church. Ask most people, oh, what do you think about Christians? Usually the first word that I get when I talk to people, hypocrite, hypocrisy. We have to change it. We have to change it. We can't change anybody else. We let the Holy Ghost, we let the Father change us. Where that our life in Christ is the only life. There's not two lives. There's not, well, I think I'm going to just, you know, whatever, do this today and maybe tomorrow get around to the things of God. That's a wrong heart. You need to let God change you. You need to let him do the work, the foundational work again. We have to start living differently. You might say, I've been hearing I have to start living differently for 10 years. I'm changing. I'm doing things. Awesome. Thank you. You need to change. There's more. There's more change, right? Again, where is the fullness, the measure, the maturity, the perfect man, even Christ Jesus? Where is that at? Where is it being exemplified? I don't see it. I'm talking to myself here. So what am I saying? Father, I got to change. Father, I want to change. Show me the things that I must do. Show me the areas where I've allowed things to be waffling, where I've allowed compromise, where I'm not devoted to this. If you will devote yourself to it, if this truly will be your reality, your life, now, not yours, but Christ that lives in you, complete change, complete contrast. We won't recognize you in 6 months. We won't recognize you in a year. Say, who is that? That's what God wants. God is looking for anybody. His eyes go to and fro, and he's not picky. He's saying, I need somebody to use. I want to use someone. He's just looking for a yielded heart, someone who's going to get serious about this. Do not be lullabied. Do not get comfortable. If you're feeling a little uncomfortable right now, good. You should welcome it because that means something's changing, something's moving around. Growth can be uncomfortable. How many people remember having growing pains? I doubt there is anyone who would say, man, you know what? If you had the choice, forget the growing pains. I want to stay this tall. No. You endure a little bit of the stretch to grow up, to get a matured body. Why would you not want to go through a little bit of the press, a little bit of the uncomfortable, to see some growth happen in your life? It's worth it. It's worth it. We have got to see some matured saints, some matured people of God who know who they are, who can speak the truth in boldness, who will not bow to the dictates of humanism, of popular opinion, who's not going to be pulled into the celebrity Christianity that is just running rampant today. I don't know if you guys see it or watch it or look at it, but I do because my heart cries out asking God, where's the church? Father, where's the church? And I look at the people that are supposed to be these big churches, and it's rough. It's bad news. It does not feel right. Primarily because it isn't. And I'm not going to apologize for talking about those things that are not right. You might say, oh, he's picking on another church and he's... I'm going to declare what God has spoken. One of the most popular things I hear as I talk to people today is, oh, it was such an awesome church. It wasn't judgy. It wasn't judgy. What in the world does that mean? I know what it means. It means come as you are and leave as you came. Jesus never said, come as you are, leave as you came. He said, come as you are and be changed. And we have to preach the gospel. We as God's servants must declare his judgments. They are not our judgments, they are his judgments. And if we speak anything differently, then we are liars. The simple reality of the gospel is laid out for anyone to read. Call it rough, call it hard, call it whatever you want. It's what Jesus spoke, and it's what we must declare. The intercessors of hell, something that God has put on my heart for quite some time now. Those that are being used by the satanic realm to just spew out constantly everything that is on Satan's agenda. It's a loud voice. It doesn't take a very keen ear to hear it. It is just bombarding everywhere you look, everywhere you turn. Where are the people who will be God's intercessors? Come on. Father, thank you for that Thank you for the heart. Father, thank you that you raise up in this place those who will be your intercessors, those who will speak forth the word. You don't have to have a microphone in your hand. The influence, the network, the people that God has placed within your sphere, speak it out. Speak out what God has placed in your mouth. Speak out. You need to have every morning the word of God burning inside of you. The word of God must be shut up in your bones like fire. You can't help but speak it out. Somebody has got to declare God's way. Somebody has got to declare what is right and what is wrong. Truth is the new hate speech. Does that change the reality of it being truth? No, it does not. We must speak the truth in love, but speak the truth. Always inviting, always welcoming the change, because that's why we're speaking. We're not speaking to condemn and say, you're right and I'm wrong. It is simply an invitation to please change. The way you're living is wrong. God's judgment is against, his wrath abides on the children of disobedience. So the invitation is, don't be a children of disobedience anymore. Come be a child of God. Amen? Do not allow false finish lines. Pastor Ruth has ministered on this before, and it's radical. False finish lines. Areas that you would say, yep, I'm good. I'm saved. I'm full of the Holy Ghost. I go to the abiding place, and they're super cool. I'm good. No, that is not good enough. False finish lines are areas, are places, is a realm of complete compromise. You turn lukewarm quick. We all are in desperate need of getting out of false realities and stepping into the reality of God. When you start to lay this out, if you were to take this short sermon that I'm talking tonight, some of you might not think it's so short, these things that I'm speaking, say, all right, I really want to get a hold of this. I want, and you list out your reality, what you see as truth, what you see as your reality, and what God's word defines as reality. And you start comparing and contrasting and saying, God, these are areas I've got to change. These are things that I've got to correct. That's what it takes. There are very few people, if any, where God's going to come and he's going to audibly speak to you and say, this is what you need to change. You have to decide within your heart, I'm going to get serious enough about this where I'm going to lay it out. I'm going to see, what is it that I truly believe? What is it that I define as my reality? And how does that match up when you lay it up against the word of God? Get serious, first and foremost, about your eternal soul. Because, hey, that weighs in the balance. Is what you believe really the truth? Is that reality? You have to define that and answer that for yourself. Look at what God says. He makes it so simple for us. It's not complex. Simple, simple things. Look at the reality of the gospel. The truth of what God has done is absolute. Absolute. Ezekiel 36:26. A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. And I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will put a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes. That's done. That's the reality of what takes place every time a person is willing to come before the Lord with sincerity and truth, call upon his name, repent, turn away from their life, and walk after those things that he has laid out. That is the reality. Now, the question is, and what I'm posing to you tonight, is are you going to stay there or are you going to move on and mature in the things of the Spirit? Are you going to be a babe tossed to and fro, or will you be a son established in the house? We choose on a daily basis whether we're going to walk in the Spirit, whether we're going to walk after the things that God has ordained, or whether we're going to just go it alone, whether we're going to do it our way and you're going to accomplish the same task, whether or not God's with you. That's the question. That's the reality of what I'm trying to get across. The contrast. Human existence versus a spiritual walking in the realms of the Spirit. We must allow God to take us over into this new reality. Colossians 1:13, who has delivered us from the power of darkness and has translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son. We must decide every day how we're going to live, how we're going to think, and base our existence off of the Word. Decide to live in the Spirit. Acknowledge the Holy Spirit every day. Allow him to truly lead you, to truly guide you. The Holy Spirit is so precious. He's so sacred. We must honor him. He's a tender touch. He waits, earnestly waits for us to just seek him, to call upon him. Come out of the world and step into a new reality. The realms of heaven await you. Why would you delay? One of the things we've been doing here as a church, as a body, is coming up to the front and touching heaven, interacting with the realms that God would have, this life of the Spirit. It's not just to do a couple times a week. It's supposed to be how you live. It's simply the introduction. It's like a little taste, a little sample. Try some. It's good. You like it? Okay, get a bunch and take it home. Right? You with me? It must be how you live your life. Live every day for him, every day with him. The church is in desperate need of power. The church is in desperate need of the demonstration of the Holy Ghost. Acts 1:5. For John truly baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. The Holy Ghost was poured out. We received the gift of the Holy Ghost, this ability to walk in the Spirit. We must do it. Only the Holy Ghost, only the power of the Holy Spirit can bring the change. Only the power of the Holy Ghost can change men's lives. Again, first and foremost with us, and then those who we can reach. Thank you, Father. God has freely given. He has freely poured out the precious gift of the Holy Spirit. Every single day there is a fresh baptism. Every day there is a fresh outpouring. Do not miss out. You don't want to miss out. Get hungry, get desperate, get thirsty, and see God move in your life that you could not, like you could not have even imagined. It'll change everything about the way you live. I want everyone to stand with me. The Holy Spirit is always there for us. He's always with us. He'll always do those things that we ask the Father. But he demands we walk in holiness. He demands consecration. When I opened up tonight, the message, what was going forth, is a rededication, a consecration to living a new level of commitment. It goes deeper, it goes deeper, it goes deeper. There's not a limit to it. The level of consecration and the level of the anointing, proportional. The greater the consecration, the greater the anointing. You want to get desperate, you want to get hungry to see God use you, to anoint you, to speak his word, to go everywhere representing Jesus. Those things that Pastor Mark has been ministering over the past, I guess it's been the past 4 weeks, Romans 8. The sonship. The Holy Spirit now in us. Therefore now being no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. Coming and walking after the Spirit. This is what we as the abiding place are purposed and destined to do. Father, I thank you for your anointing in this place. Father, in Jesus' name, thank you that every heart, let your floodlight of heaven shine. Every heart would look. Every heart would let you search. Father, show us those things that you would have us change. Father, show us those areas where we have looked to our own ability, where we have not relied solely on the Holy Spirit. Father, we want to walk after the Spirit. Lord Jesus, we want to do those things that you have purposed for us to do. Father, that the reality of the gospel, Father, the reality of those things that you did through your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, would be done in our lives. Father, that we would be Jesus' representatives on the earth. Father, we thank you, we love you, we praise you.
It's high time that we mind the things of the Spirit. It's high time that we mind the things of the Spirit. To have a voice, you must mind the things of the Spirit. It's not a human voice. It's a spiritual voice. So it's bring the change. There's been too much of the flesh that's been allowed in our lives. It's high time that we mind the things of the Spirit. That we have a voice of the Spirit. That we speak things after the Spirit. That we see things after the Spirit. There's two things that have to change in this house. It's two things that are holding people back here. It's dishonor and it's dissension. In three areas. To the anointing, to the anointed, and to the brethren. The brethren also being yourself. The discouragement to yourself. Not speaking the word over yourself. Seeing your brethren moving out in faith and speaking a word of dissension and discouragement. You're not minding the things of the Spirit. You're dishonoring the things of the Spirit and you'll never have them. It's high time we mind the things of the Spirit. We honor the things of the Spirit. I've been so blessed by Chris Graham. He's been helping me. I wanted to know what it looked like to do double honor. When we host ministries or just around my dad, I want to know, how do I double honor my dad for the man of God that he is? How do I double honor my brother for the man of God that he is? My brothers, my sisters, my husband. Parents, your children wear your problems on their face, and I'm sick of looking at it. You don't like it? Leave. Go repent and get right, or you're not welcome here. This is why I don't take the microphone, because I don't have anything to lose. It's high time we mind the things of the Spirit. It's high time that we recognize the Holy Spirit in us. It's high time that we see the blood of Jesus for the beauty that it is. Look at where your priorities are. Take measure of your life. When is the last time you were compelled to talk to someone about Jesus? You were compelled. When was the last time? When was the last time that you touched heaven that wasn't a formula? Wasn't a formula of what you think is touching heaven, but was actually touching heaven. When's the last time that you knocked on heaven's door and God heard you? And you knew right then in the place that you were at, that you were on a portal to heaven right there. That God's ear was to you. He said, I'm listening to what you're saying right now. When was the last time you knew that? What are you doing with your time? When was the last time you felt the weight of your cross? When you felt the splinters of your cross digging into your back? The church has become comfortable with compromise instead of uncomfortable in the consecration. It's high time we mind the things of the Spirit. There is a gravity to maturity in the things of God. There is a current in this world that you can float on and go into the broad way. But in the things of God, there's a gravity and maturity that is against the current. It is desperation. It is passion. It is sweat. It is tears. It is making adjustments, continual adjustments to perfection. We don't look to ourselves. We look to Jesus. We need to stop cursing ourselves, and we need to stop cursing each other. We need to stop cursing the anointing by saying, oh, it's just Daniel. That's just how he is. Oh, it's just Ruth. Oh, it's just Pastor. Oh, it's just the Spitsbergen family. I'm going to pick on the Spitsbergens because it's usually where, you know. Oh, it's just the Spitsbergens. That's just how they are. Well, my God, you should hear the things that the Lord thinks about your genetics. He wants to change that. These strongholds, these family chains of dishonor and dissension, these curses that you bring on yourself, there is no reason that every person in this place should not be overwhelmingly, exceedingly blessed in every area of your life. Everything that you put your hands to be blessed. There's no reason other than you're not looking at your Savior, your healer, your provider. Now you got to ask yourself, where are my priorities? What am I giving the best of my time to? One of the things I like to share with athletes is that are seeking after the things of God. When you go on a run or when you exercise really hard, really fervently, you give it your best, especially at some point in your workout, you're going to give the very hardest push of everything in you. Where there's fainting, there's just all sorts of things because you push it. You push it to the limit. Now you take that and you better be doing that and more in your prayer time. Because if you're not, you're giving more to the flesh than you are to the spirit. And it's not just for athletes. Everyone in here can apply that to whatever area of life it is. It's got to be that and more for the spirit, or you're not putting the spirit first. You're not seeking the kingdom first. You're not giving God your best. Be honest with God. He sees it anyways. He knows it anyways. He's looking for truth in the inward parts. As soon as he sees the brokenness, as soon as he sees the weakness, he says, that's my strength. You give it to me and I'll give you strength. You give it over to me and I'll fill it. I'll bless it. I'll take care of every area better than you could. Just give it to me. It's high time we mind the things of the Spirit. Parents, teach your kids honor. Teach your kids respect. Teach your kids to speak the word of God, not in a religious form, but after the Spirit, so the anointing's in it. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, this comes to an end right now in this house. The dishonor and the dissension, it comes to an end in this house so that every person in here is blessed, so that every person in here moves forward in God, so that every person in here be who they are to be in God. There has to be repentance. 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 It's not in your seat. There has to be repentance. There has to be an example of repentance.
I was going to say, as soon as Pastor Ruth is done, don't go anywhere. Come up here. The voice of the prophet is never liked in any generation. But listen to me very carefully right now. There's a breakthrough right now. As Pastor Ruth was speaking, that was radical. Hold up and listen to me. I know that there are many hungry hearts. I know that there are many desperate people that would just come rushing up as I make this call. I want this call to go out because there's something that's going to be broken tonight. If you have allowed dishonor, dissension, if you have allowed any of those things that Pastor Ruth called for, I want you to come now. There's going to be a breakthrough. There's going to be a breakthrough for you. Line up. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Learning to honor the anointing, learning to honor the things of the Spirit, no matter who it is, whether it's your best friend or someone that you cannot stand. The things of the Spirit surpass a natural earthly shell that you would see in a bodily form. We must be consecrated to honoring the anointing, not allowing any disrespect, not allowing any dissension.
Father, I thank you that you see everyone that has truth in the inward parts right now. I thank you that you come with your blood and you wash this clean. Father, we thank you for what you've done at the cross for us, that we would no longer ignore you, Jesus, no longer ignore you, Holy Spirit, but that we could continually recognize you. Father, that we would have eyes of the Spirit. I break every mind-blinding thing right now. I break every fleshly, humanistic thing right now in Jesus' name. Every hurt, every stronghold, I break it right now in Jesus' name. Father, I thank you. I thank you. I thank you right now that you do a miracle in this place. Father, that those that don't have vision, we'll have vision. Father, I thank you that you in your mercy and your grace will come intervene on behalf of these people. Father, that not one person in here would remain stuck. Father, that not one person in here would any longer allow untruthfulness in their spirits. Father, I thank you that a great reverence returns to this house. That a great fear of you, O God, returns to this house. Father, that a great honor of your presence returns to this house. Father, that we be proper representations of you and of your anointing continually, Jesus. Father, I thank you that there is dramatic change tonight. Shura baba ba shotura baba ba shundara baba ba ba shotala ba shindala ba shotara ba si. Father, I thank you that every person in this place will choose to pick up their cross continually and choose you, oh God. They'll choose you over everything in this world. They'll choose you over everything that this world has to offer, that their life will be consecrated to you, that they will realize the beauty of this life. See, we're nothing but sojourners in this earth, reaping a harvest for your kingdom. Oh, that passion and desperation would return to this house. That distraction and the love of ease and the high on themselves, the pride of life, would be broken here tonight. Father, that right here is a new beginning. Right here is a new beginning for every single person in this place to take up their call, to take up their mantle, oh God, to be used by you, oh God, that every person in this place, life would count so great for you, oh God. That every person in this place would be used so great by you, God. Every single person in this place. Father, that our mouths would be so consecrated to you to only speak your will, to only speak according to your plans. to consecrate our ears to only hear the things of the Spirit. To no longer allow ourselves to be influenced by the things of this earth. To no longer be enticed by the people or the music of this world. Or the movies or the books, whatever it is that captures you. Whatever it is that you've been unwilling to give up. I bind it right now and it be broken off of your life. Whatever hinders the joy, whatever hinders the peace, whatever hinders the Spirit, I break its power right now. Father, make us a joyful people. Make us a joyful and anointed people. Make us a people of passion. Make us a people of these works and greater. Father, that we would give ourselves to the study of your word. That we would no longer miss our days of getting ourselves the study of the word. That we would no longer meet our times with you of prayer and fellowship and communion. Oh, this race isn't convenient. It's not convenient, but it's glorious. It takes work. It takes sweat. It takes endurance. But oh, is it marvelous and wonderful? Oh, is it above what you could think or ask? It's a better life than you could have ever planned. Oh, God, make us a strong people to stand valiantly for your kingdom. Oh, that we would honor the things that you honor, oh God. That we would love the things that you love, oh God. And we stop honoring the things that don't deserve honor. That we stop making priorities for the things that don't need to be a priority. It starts in the house. It starts in your bedroom. It starts when you lay your head on your pillow. Ha! Your biggest battle is you. Get out of the way. He did it all. He fights for you continually. Just get out of the way and be happy and live in him and see him. Behold his glory. Behold his splendor. Consecrate every area of your life to the spiritual realm. If you can't consecrate it to the spiritual realm, then get rid of it. If it's a distraction from the spiritual realm, get rid of it. Go live in a cardboard box if you need to. Because if you'll do it right with truth in your heart, in consecration to God, he'll bless you far more than you would have now. Jesus. It's time for the people of God to have faith. It's time for the people of God to mature. It's time for the people of God to grow. It's time for the people of God to be who they're supposed to be. The tongue, the eyes, the ears. Get a hold of it. Get a hold of it in Jesus' name. Get a hold of it in Jesus' name. If you'd be filled up with the word and you'd be filled up in your prayers to the Lord, you won't have time to be bothering with these other things. You won't be tempted. You won't be cursing yourself. You won't be dealing with continual discouragement and sadness and depression and whatever else it is that you're carried away with, because you're too busy minding the master's business. Now, if you're having these struggles, you're not minding the master's business. It's not condemnation, it's change. Men, be the leaders of your house. Be the leaders of your house. Demonstrate it. Demonstrate it and bring it into line. Shuraba. Women, be the examples for your children. I'm not going to talk about the spirit of Jezebel or the spirit of Delilah tonight, but my God, will it be fitting? Women, you're the peace of the home. You're the peace of the children. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. There's no place for offense. There's no place for offense. You can be offended with me, but don't you dare be offended with the Holy Spirit and the Holy Spirit speaking right now. You decide if it's broken tonight, not me. You go home tonight and you decide if you're going to change. You're going to change the way you treat things in your home. You change the way you treat your husband. You change the way you speak over your children. You change the way you look at leadership. The eyes, the ears, the mouth. Our lives are here for the glory of God, and that's it. If you're not here for the glory of God, then leave. Followers, all they want is a handout. Jesus had plenty of followers. He just fed the 5,000. He walked on water. They wanted to make him king. And as soon as he demanded maturity, the crowd left and he barely kept his disciples. 5,000 were fed and they wanted to make him king. And as soon as he demanded maturity, the crowd left. Why? Because the followers, they want handouts. They want their diapers powdered. They want everything handed to them and to just sit and be a brat and make a disturbance in the place. It's time to grow and mature. It's time to be a disciple. It's time to say, how can we bless you, Lord? What can we do for you, O God? How can we serve in your kingdom with full abandonment and full consecration? Practical application. It starts in your home. It starts with your leaders, your husbands, your pastors. Shura baba ba shonda la le 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 shuta. Shura baba ba ba shi. I'm believing God for every person in this house to be a disciple of God. But my prayer is that if you do not mature and you do not grow, then you'll be removed. It's not the first time I've prayed this. And every time I've prayed, the person's been removed or they changed. And I'm praying it here tonight because I'm demanding a change here. I'm raising the bar that says there must be a demand for growth, a demand for maturity. The slightest willingness of heart, a full giving over to Jesus, that's all we need. That's all he needs to completely take over, to completely run in your life and flood it and draw you in with tender cords of loving mercy. Change isn't easy. Oh, but it's necessary. Breaking your habits of compromise will not be easy, but it is necessary to follow on and know your God. Without the change, you will be stuck. You will live in a familiar spirit. And you won't even know that God has departed from you. You become so used to what this house has from the anointing. You become hardened. You become living in a formula that you won't even see that God has left you unless you continue to grow and you continue to change. Just as Samson was a judge in his ministry, he had become so accustomed to who he was and how he did things in God that when God had departed, he didn't even know it. This house has an anointing. And with great anointing comes great responsibility. It's high time we mind the things of the Spirit. It's high time we mind the things of the Spirit so we have a voice after the Spirit.
Powerful. And Ruth has just stayed here. You can feel it. That she's just stayed here waiting on the Holy Ghost. Now, I feel the gift of faith. I feel the breakthrough. It's right here. It's here. Now, you must take a hold of it. You must take a hold of it. That's it. That's it. Because it's very easy to say, all right, cool. And then you go and you do the same thing. That the rubber meets the road. When you're willing to throw away the CD or the book or the movie or whatever it is, when you say these are the areas of compromise, these are the areas I've allowed dishonor, and you cut it off. The breakthrough is here. The breakthrough is here. The faith is here. I feel it. You must passionately take a hold of it, desperately take a hold of it, where nothing, absolutely nothing, will prevent it. It will cost everything. Everything. What you have to understand is that you may see Pastor Ruth and she comes out hard and she comes out heavy, but what you don't see is what I have seen. Her in her room weeping, crying out for each and every one of you. We do it, guys. We love you. You're our family. You're who we belong to. You're the church. Do not take offense because the word comes out strong. You must hear the heart of it. The heart of it comes out of a desperate weeping, a crying out for, Father, we want to be used by you. Father, we want to be used by you. But listen, our tears and our prayers only go so far. You must take a hold of this. You must have the relationship. You stand alone on that day before the Father. We will contend. We will fight for every soul, every person, every loved one in this place. But you must make the decision. The beautiful thing of it is, guys, is when these services take place, when the consecration goes to another level, the manifest presence is that much more glorious. The outpouring is that much thicker. Demand the change for your life. Do not allow compromise. The Holy Spirit is there. The slightest opening, He takes over. This must be your life. It is high time that we now live the life of the Spirit, that we change from our earthly ways. Father, I thank you for the word of faith that has gone forth and received into every heart, into every ear. Father, I thank you that tomorrow morning will not be another Thursday morning that is full of distractions and is full of just the whatevers. But Father, there is a notable change because it is demanded. Father, because we will demand of ourselves this life, the life of Christ. Thank you, Father, that you are there by your Holy Spirit to see it take place. Oh, hallelujah. We want the breakthrough for every person. We want the breakthrough for every person. The answer, the solution, the key, it is here, it is here, it is here. Take a hold of it. Take it home with you. Take it into your heart and live it. Take it. Just receive it in. Just receive it in. Grab a hold of it. Fresh commitments, fresh consecrations to the Father. Tonight, 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 that you live by. Here is the challenge. We have had many, many services where this takes place and you're good for a month, 2 months, 3 months, and then it falls back. You have got to get a hold of this where it is not just another service high that lasts for a little while. It becomes your life. The DNA of the kingdom is literally implanted into your very being. Where this is who you are. This is who you are. A son of God. Walking after the Spirit. Thank you, Father, that it takes place. Father, in Jesus' name, every distraction, every hindrance, everything that would come against us, we break it. In Jesus' name, Father, that you would have free course, that you would have free flow through our lives. Father, there would be advancement. There would be advancement from glory to glory. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, we thank you, Father. Thank you for your glory. In Jesus' mighty name, hallelujah.
Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. There's some people in this place tonight that you may have had a religious experience with Jesus. You may have said a prayer and be, you know, going to church, maybe a regular basis or maybe sometimes. But you're backslidden. You're not walking with God. You know you're not walking with God. You know that Jesus isn't the most important aspect of your life. You got some things in this life that you think you want to do. There's some people in here with just outright some rebellion in their life. They have things completely out of order. And Jesus is calling you tonight. He's calling you tonight. He's calling you to come. There's people that have even encountered God and had an encounter and been touched by God. But you got all wrapped up in how to figure out things for yourself. You wrapped up in how to get it all worked out. You wrapped up in offense and in hurt. You're not right with Jesus. You're not right with God. Maybe there's even a couple of people in here that you've never really totally given your life to Jesus ever before. Jesus is calling you right now. He's calling you right now to come. He's calling you right now to come. He's calling you right now to come and get it right. If you guys will back up just a little bit, I want to give a little space right here for people that need to surrender their life to Jesus right now. They need to give their life to Jesus right now because Father's in this place and He's calling you to come. He's calling you to come. You don't want to go your own way. Because look around at this earth. Look around at the destruction. Look around at all of the evil that's in this earth. You don't want to be a part of that, helping that. You don't want to be on Satan's side. You want to come to the Lord and let Him make it all right. He'll take your wrongs and He'll make them all right. He'll turn it around for you. He'll take your wrongs and He'll make them right. He's a good and a loving Father. People go about walking their own way, and then tragedy comes to their family or their friends or somewhere in their life. Their life gets messed up. They get in a situation that they never wanted to be in, and then they blame it on God. It's because it's not God's fault. Every good and perfect thing comes from the Father of lights. Every good and perfect thing comes from Him. When your life gets messed up is when you take a hold of it and you try to live it out on your own, then Satan grabs that and runs with it. If you've had hurt, pain, and destruction in your life and you're sick of it, kick the devil in the head tonight and run up here and get your life right with Jesus right now. Let Him bring the change. Let Him turn everything that the enemy has meant to destroy your life. Let Him turn it around and let it be good. Let the good come forth right now in Jesus' name. Come quickly. I'm not talking about the hungry that come up to every altar call. And basically, what I'm hearing is for those that haven't even come up yet. Because most of the ones that have come up have already made a commitment. They've gone to a deeper place. They're saying, "More, Lord, yes, Lord." I'm talking to people that are just sitting back waiting to get out, to go on, to live their life, to do their thing, to figure it out. It will bring destruction because I'm telling you, people, we're living in an hour, we're living in a day, and it's just getting worse and worse, where the enemy has been given control more and more because the church is sitting on its blessed assurance, not doing what it's supposed to be doing, not living out righteousness, truth, and holiness and purity as God's called us to live out. And you think that deception is going to let up and it's going to get easier, you're out of your mind. Right now, you stand in a place or you sit in a place where there's Holy Ghost conviction and that conviction's going into your heart, and don't turn away. Don't turn away. And don't walk out of here and take your life and try to figure it out again for another day. Give it to Jesus and let Him make your wrongs right. Let Him make your wrongs right. He's saying, "Come unto Me, all ye that are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." He wants to give you rest now. He wants to give you peace now. So I'm going to ask you one more time to come. Just put down your pride, lay it aside, and get up here. Jesus is calling. Put down your offense and your hurt. Right now, Jesus is calling. He is calling. He is calling you to come right now and to repent and to let Him take it over. But it's a turning about. It's not walking out your life the same way anymore. It's a complete about face. Come quickly. Come quickly. You're not here by accident. You came here tonight by divine purpose. God came here and drew you here to meet with you here tonight to bring a change in your life so you will never be the same. So you will have an encounter with Him that you will never be the same again. So come in Jesus' name. And I will tell you right now, not one person that I hear the Spirit calling to has come up. Not one. Not one. Not one. He's bidding you. He's calling you. But not one's come up. And you just think, "I'm walking away from Jesus. Jesus, just wants to give me everything beautiful, everything wonderful. He wants to make all my wrongs right. And I'm walking away right now tonight. I'm making a decision to walk away and go do it my own way. So you just realize that when you walk out of here.
It's heavy, man. Pastor Geneva does not just speak just to be heard. She moves under the inspiration of the Holy Ghost. Father, we thank you for the moving now of Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for the Holy Spirit now. For the Holy Spirit and power. For the Holy Spirit now. For the Holy Spirit and power. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for the Holy Spirit now. For the Holy Spirit and power. For the Holy Spirit now. For the Holy Spirit and power. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for the Holy Spirit now. For the Holy Spirit and power. For the Holy Spirit now. For the Holy Spirit and power. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for the Holy Spirit now. For the Holy Spirit and power. For the Holy Spirit now. For the Holy Spirit and power. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for the Holy Spirit now. For the Holy Spirit and power. For the Holy Spirit now. For the Holy Spirit and power. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for the Holy Spirit now. For the Holy Spirit and power. For the Holy Spirit now. For the Holy Spirit and power. Yes, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for the Holy Spirit now. For the Holy Spirit and power. For the Holy Spirit now. For the Holy Spirit and power. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We will arise and shine for you. with the light of your glory, with the light of your countenance, with the light of your glory, with the light of your face, we will arise and shine for you. We will arise and shine for you. We will.
Thank you, Jesus. Everybody's welcome to stay up here and keep worshiping, keep pressing in. I want you to just stay in this place. This is an atmosphere of change, of breakthrough, of deliverance. If you need to go, consider yourself dismissed. Remember to always come before the Lord with a tithe, with an offering, prepared to bless Him. If you need to go, slip out. God's still working, still doing things up here. But come give, find people around you, bless them, hug them, love them. We love you all and bless you in Jesus' mighty name.
We will arise and shine for you. We will arise and shine for you. We will.
We will arise and
with the light of your glory, with the light of your face, with the light of your presence, with the light of your grace, with the light of your glory, with the light of your face, with the light of your presence, with the light of your grace.
God's so good, he's still calling. He's still calling. I could come back there and get you, or you could just come up here.